Hello and welcome to NewsClick. Five human rights activists were recently arrested on charges of inciting violence during the Bhima Koregaon celebrations. These activists are also being alleged to have Maoist links, and there's also talks of a letter being found in their possession which talks of a bid to assassinate Prime Minister Narendra Modi. So today we have with us civil rights activist Gautam Navlakha to talk about the charges against these activists and the draconian laws that have been used to put them in prison. So, hello Gautam.
Thank you, Shnurangya.
Firstly, talking about this letter, which now we've also seen Sharad Pawar talking about, saying that it doesn't really follow protocol for the police to release the contents of such a letter to the public without any internal investigations, and perhaps it's a bit to gain sympathy. So what do you think about that?
Well, Mr. Sharad Pawar has said it, and it seems very clear from the contents of the letter which have been made public. And I would like to compliment the police for sharing the contents of the letter with the Indian public, because the letter makes it clear that it's one of the most unlikely plot aimed at assassinating a prime minister, if it was supposed to be that. It's one of the most ridiculous letters I've come across, especially from so-called very dreaded underground movement. So, and I think I agree with Sharad Pawar that not only does it break protocol, much more than that, its authenticity has yet to be established.
And this letter is one of the primary evidences against these activists. Talking about these activists, while they are being blamed for this Bhima Koregaon violence, we know that the two Hindutva leaders who were largely responsible, Milind Ekbote and Sambhaji Bhide, they are still free. Bhide was not even called for questioning. And these activists are, the work they have been doing is, of course, can be seen as threatening to the government, because they were also involved, very active in Gachiroli, in land rights issues and human rights issues. So what do you think is the larger motive of this? Is there a larger motive to this rather than just the Bhima Koregaon violence?
Well, let's look at the two issues which are very important. They have referred to the fact that the violence in Bhima Koregaon on January 1st, 2018 was a result of a conspiracy which was engineered by these so-called five persons. Maybe they'll drag some other people also into this dragnet. This flies in the face of facts as we know it, because the violence that took place on 1st was directed against Dalits. It was not the Dalits who were coming to commemorate 200th anniversary of victory over Peshwas by the largely Mahar army of the British to commemorate that. They had no reason to engage in violence when they had been gathering there for years, since 1927, when Dr. Ambedkar started this practice. And this year we knew that there would be much larger turnout also, primarily because of its 200th anniversary, the bicentenary of Bhima Koregaon. So therefore, Dalits had no reason to. In fact, they had everything to gain from a peaceful, if that had been allowed to be held, that would actually, the political message would have been far bigger an issue than what happened later. I mean, by allowing the Hindutva forces, which were led by, which leaders are Milind Ekbote and Sambhaji Bhide. Mm-hmm. Sambhaji Bhide is personally very close to our Prime Minister, it seems. So that's one of the reasons why he's not been touched. Yeah. But the important thing is that there are court orders, both the lower court, high court, as well as the Supreme Court on February 20th of this year, where it admonished the Maharashtra police that on the one hand you say that Ekbote and others are evading arrest, whereas they are going about it and you are making no efforts efforts to arrest them. So they ordered that instead of making excuses, they should go and arrest the person who have been mentioned in the FIR, which they didn't follow, because Sambhaji Bhide still remains scot-free, and Milind Ekbote is out.
He was released on bail.
Yeah. So it also depends on what kind of sections or what sections of law that were invoked against Ekbote and Bhide, in contrast to, for fomenting violence, for actually fomenting violence, in contrast to these five who have been, I believe, been charged under a fictitious claim of offenses against them, without there being any link or fact of any link between the violence that took place at the hands of the Hindutva forces and these five people who were actually part of the organizers. I mean, they played, Sudhir Dhavale actually played an important role in organizing this the rally. He was one of the leading organizers of it, and it was perfectly legitimate what he engaged in. So it depends on what kind of charge sheets, because here we see these people have been charged with the most draconian provisions of law, in contrast to the provisions of law invoked for those who are actually engaged in violence. There is no claim of violence on them. There is not a proof that they engaged in violence or they encouraged people to plot to create violence on the bicentenary when families would be present. Consider the way in which the police acts. Police, when it went to arrest Milind Ekbote claimed that he was sitting in puja and the police would have to wait. Our police now, which has become so faithful, waited for 2 hours till he finished his puja and then arrested. When they went to arrest Sudhir Dhavale,
he was
in his night pajamas. He was not even allowed to change his clothes. They just dragged him out and took him into prison. I mean, this shows also that the police is sympathetic towards the Hindutva elements who are actually involved in Bhima Koregaon violence, and therefore they are doing nothing to bring them to book. But they are going out of their way to change the narrative, divert attention from the real culprits, and arrest people under the most draconian laws. Now, what does it mean if one's Unlawful Activities Prevention Act or provisions are invoked? Look at it. I mean, the provisions that have been invoked against them for Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, they are sections 13, 16, 17, 18, 18B, 38, 39, 40. Each one of them more dreadful than the other. Remarkable thing about Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, as it was true of Tada and Pota, is that it creates an offense, allows for the authorities to ban an organization in the name of curbing that offense, and then brings under its dragnet everybody that they can by suggesting that they have some link. Either they are members or supporters or sympathizers, or they are helping a banned organization. This is precisely what happened in the infamous Gadchiroli case, where five people were given life imprisonment, including G.N. Sai Baba, Prasant Rahi, Hem Mishra, Pandu Narot, and Tikri, Mahesh Tikri, I think. These five people were given, and Vijay Tikri has been given 10 years rigorous imprisonment. The only basis for it is membership of an unlawful organization. There was no evidence of them having committed any crime or even plotting to create a crime. But the sheer fact that they could be made to appear as being members or supporters of a banned organization, and that too based on so-called recovery of banned literature. The banned literature, there is no such thing under Indian jurisprudence which is called banned literature.
And of course, the Supreme Court also says that just mere membership of a banned organization is no grounds for...
But what Unlawful Activities Prevention Act does is that once you ban an organization, it allows for two things. It can drag in people that you want to ensnare and charge with all kind of charges, as has happened in this case, and it was true of the Gadchiroli case in which G.N. Sai Baba and others were implicated. Here are five people. Sudhir Dhavale is a very well-known Dalit activist, ideologue, writer, and literary figure. Suren Gadling is a practicing lawyer of 25 years.
And he was also defending Jain Sahib.
And he has been defending the most downtrodden and those who are most marginalized, for whom very few people are willing to come forward. He was defending them.
He was defending many UAPA cases.
Shoma Sen teaches English, and yes, she is an activist in civil liberties and social activist, social movements as well as women's rights movement. And then you have Mahesh Rawat, who has nothing to do with it. Mm-hmm. His case is related to actually to Gachchiroli. Because he's worked there as one of the research fellows who was selected by the Prime Minister's
to
implement all the rural development programs in Gachchiroli. He worked for them. He has been active actually in the Vistapan Virodhi Janandolan in Gachchiroli, which is aimed at stopping, stalling, and scuttling attempts to increase mining operation in Gachchiroli. In fact, there are 27 mining licenses against which the people are agitating. And exactly as in Niyamgiri, please remember, exactly as in Niyamgiri, Surajgarh Mount hilltop is a sacred place. And there is a Supreme Court order very clearly spells out in the Orissa mining case, where they lay out that it is Gram Sabha's right to decide what is sacred, religious, what activities can affect their religious practice, etc., etc. Ignoring all this without holding even a public hearing properly. In fact, doing it in such a way that it did not allow people to participate in a public hearing in Surajgarh. They have been pushing for increasing mining and mining production and clamping down on everybody who protests, accusing them of being Maoist. Now, once Unlawful Activities Prevention Act comes into play, and once you have banned an organization, it seems that anybody who has anything to say can be accused of being a Maoist. And people get scared. Yes. And they get scared by being associated with Maoists. I would like to point out that despite proscription of an organization, an idea cannot be proscribed, an ideology cannot be proscribed. And this is something which is there in the Supreme Court or judgments one after another, which make it very clear that advocacy of an ideology on an idea, including violence, is not a crime. It's inciting violence which is a crime. Using this as a principle, it's very clear that if somebody espouses or somebody writes in favor of or somebody says that what is being done to the Maoist or people who are being accused of Maoist is unfair, wrong, and so on and so forth, they're fully justified. I mean, people have a right to believe in the ideology of Godse, who's an assassin of Gandhi. Civil liberties movements and all have not come out and said, please ban these people and put them behind bars. That would be absurd. If an idea is absurd, it will sink. But if an idea carries weight, that is what scares the authorities. And I think what has happened in this particular case, it is that both in Gachchiroli and Bhima Koregaon, the protest, the resistance is making the government very, very nervous. Because neither the Adivasis are giving up in Gachchiroli their protests and resistance against the mining corporations that are trying to move in a big way, which would completely transform and destroy one of the prime forests that we have, especially in this day and age when we talk about climate change. My point is that Gachchiroli, where the Adivasis are resisting, and please remember, when the judge passed his judgment in the Gachchiroli case, he made this point that these people are thwarting development and they're coming in the way of development. And they're one of the reasons for the problems that Gachchiroli Adivasis face is because of lack of development. Not even once he asked whether the development that the Adivasis wanted is the development that the government is imposing on them or not. And if you look at Bhima Koregaon similarly, where again, the protests and the resistance against it and demand for bringing the real culprits to book has galvanized a large section of the population, and they're not giving up. They're not giving up. So I think that these calls for taking a serious look at Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, which is worse than TADA and POTA.
It's also, I think, important to point out that when important provision of POTA was actually removed, which called about, which legalized communal clashes, inciting of communal clashes as being, was one of the sections which was actually removed from UAPA, under which we could have had Milindek, Bote, and all of which, it could have been put against them, but that section was removed.
Not only that section, I mean, it's very interesting that the TADA and POTA definition of terror acts and terrorism is identical in UAPA. They also did away with one clause of POTA, which was that if any police officer engages in malicious prosecution, that police officer can be prosecuted under that act. Now, this too was removed from Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. Quite apart from that, actually, there is nothing like Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. If you compared UAPA with TADA and POTA, TADA and POTA are a pale reflection of Unlawful Activity Prevention Act as well as its draconian provisions for two reasons. One, there is no sunset clause in Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, unlike TADA and POTA, which, if not renewed, they would lapse. The second is, because it's a permanent act, and because there was Unlawful Activities Prevention Act in 1967, which dealt with unlawful, and you made terrorist activities also part of this act has become an omnibus act in itself. And it creates two categories of banned organization. One, banned as unlawful for what they claim, preaching or propagating, secession or separatist, you know, support for separatist movements, etc., etc. And the other is terrorist act, which is defined as acts which threaten or likely to threaten the integrity and sovereignty of the state and things so on and so forth. My point is that when you have such an omnibus act, which has such provisions from unlawful to terrorist, what this act does is that allows the police to charge a person even with the most fictitious or fake information or evidence that they can make, knowing fully well that they can retain a person in the police custody for more than 30 days if they need, which is dangerous in itself, because the normal Indian penal code does not allow that. Plus, it may be years before you get bail, because getting bail once Unlawful Activities Prevention Act is invoked is next to impossible. Judges are wary of giving bail because the law also obliges. There is a provision here that without the concurrence of the prosecutor, the bail cannot be given to an accused. The point is that this becomes a way in which you keep a person incarcerated, a person whom you dislike or you fear, or whose activities you fear, thinking that it's going to, you know, galvanize opposition to the government, etc. So Unlawful Activities Prevention Act may not result in conviction. It rarely does, because even in the SIMI cases, you'll notice that 75 to 80% of the people who have been charged under an Unlawful Activities Prevention Act for various crimes have been acquitted, as the Jamia Millia Teachers Association in their reports and documentation have brought out so very well. The Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, like TADA and POTA, is not meant primarily to ensure higher conviction rates, rather to enable the police to keep imprisoned those people or those groups, silence those groups that it finds problematic for its own reason. And there, this allows them to keep a person behind bars without the bother of a trial as a form of punishment for years together. And this is despite the Supreme Court pontificating that bail is a right, not jail. Well, it seems that the rich, the privileged, and the powerful can avail of this provision that the Supreme Court has spelled out of bail, whereas ordinary citizens of this country, and especially those who have been condemned and declared as criminals by the sheer fact that UAPA has been invoked against them, they have to suffer incarceration for years together.
Primary example of that is G.N. Sai Baba, who despite being 90% disabled has been in prison for a very long time. Yeah. So thank you, Gautam, for joining us today, and thank you for watching NewsClick.
Thank you, sir.